My name is Jane Pillinger, and I'm deeply honoured to be chairing this launch. And we have a distinguished panel today. And you'll be able to see from the bios in the flyer that you will have received for this launch a bit more information about our distinguished panel. And we've got colleagues and students hopefully attending from three faculties in the OU and some friends and colleagues from beyond the OU as well. A quick thank you to the three centres that have funded this launch. That's the Higher Education Research Council, the OU's Innovation, Knowledge and Development Unit, and the Centre for Global Challenges and Social Justice. Just to say that this session will be recorded and it will be made later available at a later stage on YouTube and the OU website. Here's a brief overview of the agenda before we get started. First of all, Professors Nicola Yeates and Ross Fergusson, both from the Department of Social Policy and Criminology at the Open University, are going to give an overview of the book. And that will be followed by a very short Q&A session with people attending. So if you do want to ask a question, please put your questions in the chat. And we'll try and cover as many questions as possible, and if necessary, we can group them. And at this stage, if you don't have any questions, that's fine. That gives us more time for discussion with our panel. After that, we'll hear from our two discussants. That's Professor Heidi Gottfried, who's the Professor of Sociology at Wayne State University in the United States, and Robin Simmons, who's a Professor of Education at the University of Huddersfield, and they will give their commentary and critical perspectives on the book, and will be followed by a short dialogue between Nicola and Ross and the discussants, and then a chance to ask, we'll have more time then to ask, for you to ask more questions, give your views, points for discussion. And again, if you're thinking about questions or points you want to make, please put them in the chat. And then we'll hear some responses from our authors and discussants before we do the final roundup and close. So we're going to hear about the book and particularly how, and I think what's really fantastic about this book is it tackles the multiple challenges arising for global governance, political economy, with the intersection of social policy and global social injustice. It's no easy task, but I want to say that Nicola and Ross, you've tackled this in a really impressive and scholarly way. So without further ado, I'm going to pass over to Nicola and Ross to give us an overview of the book. And you've got about 15 minutes for this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Jane, and good evening to everyone who's made time to join us here this afternoon. So I'm going to begin by providing a brief overview of our book, and then I'll hand over to Ross to pick up the mantle. Because we're on time limitations, of necessity we'll be drawing selectively from it, you'll be pleased to hear, and providing a flavour of the content, the themes and the argument. So what's our book about? Well, at one level it's about the worldwide incidence, distribution and dynamics and impacts of youth unemployment. We take a broad view of youth unemployment, meaning not just open unemployment or registered unemployment and those receiving benefits of some kind, but also hidden unemployment, those who are jobless, underemployed or warehoused in educational training schemes or in some other marginal economic activity. Now, our curiosity to look at this issue closely on an international scale was prompted in part by statistics such as these. So you can see here two pie charts showing the rise in the percentage of 15 to 24 year olds who are unemployed. So that's one driver. Another driver which speaks from the statistics is how youth unemployment has seemingly become endemic. So it's a universal phenomenon. It's a universal, entrenched and enduring characteristic of the world economy across all continents, across all countries, state types, political, economic and welfare system types. In Africa, across Africa, parts of Asia, Europe and beyond, unemployment has been consistently sustained, sometimes up to 30% and even 50% of the youth labour force. And that's a phenomenal proportion, as well as being enormous numbers in absolute terms. And of course, but unsurprisingly, there are vast gender disparities here. So unemployment rates of young women are on average 16 to 18 percentage points higher than those of men. So we look across in the book, we have vast data reservoir, if I may say it. So there's a number of different sources of and types of data that we draw upon. But most importantly, I think maybe for now is to emphasise that we look across more than 100 countries across all continents and country income groupings, and over the course of more than a century. And to our knowledge, this is the first study that combines such an extensively internationalist perspective with a long historical frame. So at one level, our book's obviously about youth unemployment, as the title on the book says. Another level, our book aims to offer a newish history of the global political economy of labour in general and of youth labour in particular. And we wanted to focus very much on the dynamics of global restructuring, global labour forces and their global governance, and to bring a different perspective into the academic field, which is still largely characterised by country level studies of national, so-called national institutions of work, education and welfare. So in the book, we argue consistently, that global forces, structures and institutions are key drivers in shaping young people's terms of inclusion into work and jobs, and also their exclusion from both. But that's not to say that the nation state is irrelevant or that states don't matter. So there we go. So to move on to the next slide, this book is in many ways about age and the significance of age, about how, when, why and where it matters. And we marshal evidence and data from a number of sources as to why unemployment hits young people so much harder than older groups, how it's produced and reproduced both within and across generations, countries and continents, the impacts of that social position in terms of the scarring, the lifetime scarring often that young people experience, the advantages to owners of capital and to employers, and the political and other repercussions for governments. And last, but by no means least, what is to be done about it? So we shall return later in the session to the what is to be done question. But at this stage, before I hand to Ross, I just want to emphasise three summary statements that encapsulate central theses within the book. One, just as labour in general is a major social force actively shaping globalising dynamics, then so is youth labour. Young adults, we argue, are not just an age-specific cohort of adults. For employers, for example, study after study shows youth signals the body and mentality and the structural social position of the ideal worker that they so cherish. Two, and following on from this, age matters. It really matters. It matters greatly to the degree that we think has not really been appreciated in its full extent as much as it should be. Young people are differentially and severely impacted by so-called routine workings of the global economy and by crises. Their labour, youth labour, the use and abuse in the past, as in today, lies at the heart of our book. Three, and finally, from me. Cross-border spheres of governance are an active part of this picture. They're not just part of the background, the contextual background, kind of passive, somewhat ephemeral social and political actors. So be it the League of Nations historically, or more contemporarily, the United Nations or the Bretton Woods institutions, these all structure the social position of youth labour, not just in one country, but in many, many countries. In fact, we would argue most countries that belong to these institutions. So as we argue, tracking the long history of global normative frameworks, their development shows a diverse and vibrant transnational community of education activists, labour activists, welfare activists, that over the course of the 20th and well into the 21st century, very active and engaged in the making and the remaking of global and regional and national social policy through these cross-border spheres of governance. And we also chart the ongoing tensions between protective, competitive and exploitative currents, and how these tensions will reconcile amongst different actors within these forums. So we have to consider these forums, we argue, if we are to understand how country-level institutions of work and welfare and education, at least as regards to young people, have been made and remade over time. Youth labour, we argue, has been integral to the global and not just the national politics of social policy. Thank you. At this stage, I'm going to pass over to Ross.
Okay, good. Thanks, Nicola. Can people hear me? Raise something if you can't. Really good. Thank you. Okay. I'm going to try and give you a bit more of a sense of the structure and organisation of the book, helped by some of the graphics that I think Nicola's putting up on the screen as well. So we've thought of the book in its broadest terms of three principal terrains that provide a focus and a structure for our narrative across the seven substantive chapters 2 to 8. The first of these concerns how young labour is differentially embroiled in globalisation processes, including the terms of their inclusion in and exclusion from new economic opportunities. After introducing the concept of endemic youth unemployment and its significance as a major social policy issue of our time in chapter 2 and thereafter, chapters 3 and 4 then go on to locate youth unemployment in relation to the size and shape of the global youth labour force and the ongoing restructuring of the world economy over the last century or so. Okay, our second terrain concerns the impacts of global economic and financial crises on young members of the workforce. Chapter 5 discusses how such crises fall disproportionately heavily on young people, and it presents new data on how they play out across genders, countries and world regions. And Chapter 6 focuses on data across almost 30 years to 2018 and how it differs across high, middle and lower and low country income groups. Then our third terrain, looking in a different direction again, concerns the institutional architectures of global social governments and policy formation and how they set out the global rules that structure economic accumulation and distribution, including how youth labour is treated. So chapters 7 and 8 focus on the historical panorama of campaigns to govern youth labour through key intergovernmental organisations with often conflicting priorities. So to get behind some of these rather broad abstractions, I'll briefly illustrate some specific concrete aspects of the routine workings of the global economy that the book discusses, focusing here on three examples among many others that we could have chosen. Excuse me, I've got a sore throat. First, there are many historical and recent examples of the impacts of labour and entrepreneurial practices on young people and their work and security. Here are two of them. Our rereading of Frederick Engels, Pioneering Research in England in 1844 to 45, draws attention to factory workers' youthful reserve armies of labour that they could deploy and dismiss as demand fluctuated, and also how essential young people's bodies and minds were, how capital outsourced the costs of labour reproduction. Engels' study included the international workings of the capitalist industrialization, where this same logic applied. Indeed, Engels found that across the whole British Empire, almost half of factory operatives were aged under 18 years, including girls and young women. More recently, a huge literature people will be knowledgeable of, no doubt, describes the extensive internationalization of production as owners and managers of capital relocated production and labor to low-income countries. Froebel and colleagues' famous 1979 study charted the emergence of the new international division of labour that shows how industries in core countries like Germany were relocating production to Asia, South America and Central and Eastern Europe. Our analysis of their data confirms that age was a major structuring device. Under 20-year-olds predominated among workforces in the outsourced production lines that typically paid wages that were between 10 and 20% of their German counterparts' wages. The second aspect of the global dynamics of youth labour is how in the last three decades, youth unemployment rates have risen steadily across widely differing country income groups, as Nicola mentioned earlier. Two dynamic charts will illustrate this graphically. The first one shows the continuous growth of global youth unemployment rates since 1991, compared to the low-level flat rates that prevailed amongst adult workers. The 2008 vertical line there marks the global financial crisis, of course. The second chart, which I'll go straight onto, is a slightly more complex one, we'll give a bit more time for, shows the continuous rise in youth unemployment rates over 30 years in lower, middle and especially upper middle income groups, notably contrasting with the speedy recovery from high unemployment in high income countries soon after the financial crisis. And we'll just let this play out now. And now just watch, this is high income groups coming up in yellow, and huge peak there after the financial crisis, and then a very happy, rapid recovery comparing to the other groups. The third and final example we highlight here is the global governance of youth unemployment, which has a complex, entangled, century-long history. Chapter 7 and 8 interpret this. Since the 1970s, the incorporation of youth unemployment into the mainstream of United Nations youth policy has marked a significant break with post-war, post-Second World War peace and justice goals. This shift coincided with predominantly neoliberal priorities shaping global economic restructuring. Since the early 2000s, this reset has been consolidated by greater involvement of multinational businesses and third sector corporations in policy development, funding and delivery regarding youth unemployment. The International Labour Organization, alongside this, has been incrementally repositioned away from strategic actor status in setting labour standards and holding governments and others to account, and towards managing localised palliative country level projects without strengthening labour rights at the global level. So just to close very quickly, I know I'm slightly over time. We end this brief overview by reiterating the key premise that the book, the economic youth unemployment can only be adequately interpreted and addressed by reference to social organisation and social relations of labour, work, education and welfare that span country borders. Throughout the book, we aim to combine macro and micro level analyses to depict some of the upstream causes and downstream effects of academic youth and endemic youth unemployment. So for now, thank you for your attention. We look forward to any immediate questions, and then we'll be passing over to our two esteemed discussants. Sorry for overrunning slightly.
Fantastic. Really, it's really interesting seeing that last table as well. That's really, thank you so much, Ross and Nicola, for such a really comprehensive, insightful, really interesting overview of the book. It's hard to define in 15 minutes such a complex issue that you've discussed in the book. So we've just got a couple of minutes for any questions, and I can see there's one already in the chat from Sandipine from the National University of Singapore. And Sandipine asks, in terms of further research, do you see youth unemployment being accommodated in the notion of the precariat, that contemporary youth are more insecure than at other points in history? I don't know who wants to answer that. So the role of the precariat, youth unemployment, Ross.
I'll take a first go at it, and Nicola might want to add. I can give you a very simple answer. The default is that indeed young people without work are indeed incorporated into precariat, and they're simply the buffer between the need for expanded and contracted labour. Great for business, pretty not so good for young workers or unemployed young would-be young workers.
Nicola, do you want to add anything?
My point, well, no, that's great. I mean, I guess just on the historical point, which is implicit in the question, I'm not particularly going to duck this one, but I could on a point of methodology, which is how do we know that the young people might be more insecure now than at any other point in history? But taking the question a bit more kind of loosely, if I may, I mean, the precariat isn't a framework that I work with personally. Speaking, and we haven't in the book either. But certainly, in terms of young people, young people's insecurity, I guess, I mean, that's been a constant actually throughout the entire time that we've looked at and for which there is data in terms of the structural kind of position within the global or indeed national kind of labour market. All the indicators point out that young people have consistently been at a disadvantaged position, discriminated against compared with older people. And that goes right, that holds true right the way across a whole range of different sectors, as it were, of the economy, of welfare. I'm not an educationalist, but maybe, you know, Ross or Robin might want to speak about the education aspects. So I'd certainly say that that's a constant structural position of disadvantage, younger people compared with older people. And that deserves further investigation. I mean, in this book, we've only managed to kind of, you know, put together a, you know, the kind of, I guess, the first go of an argument which actually prioritizes youth, well, the younger or kind of, well, it's not really, yeah, so the younger element of the adult population, much more needs to be done. So I'd be supportive of anybody actually who continues to look at youth unemployment from that perspective.
Great. And I'm sure we can come back to these issues, particularly in the Global South, where so many people are, in any case, working in the informal economy, where much of that data isn't recorded. So thanks very much to both of you. And I'm now going to move on to the next part of the agenda, which is the response from our two distinguished respondents, discussants. First of all, I'd like to introduce Professor Heidi Gottfried. I hope Heidi is still with us. We were having some problems with connection. And Heidi is Professor of Sociology at Wayne State University in the United States. Heidi, are you there?
Can you hear me?
I can indeed, we can.
Wonderful, that's good to be with you. Using a transnational analytic, global youth unemployment diagnoses an acute but understudied phenomena. The book examines the intertwined fates of young workers in the global North and South, bringing together an impressive amount of data on global production and a nuanced argument on global production, building out a vast literature, a veritable who's who of both classic and contemporary economic and social theory. Ross Fergusson and Nicola Yeates rewrite the history of capitalism through the prism of age. Youth unemployment is like the canary in the coal mine for assessing the consequences of global neoliberal restructuring. And in broad strokes, the book condenses the arc of the past century by crisscrossing the globe in what will surely become the touchstone text to studying the quantum shift of endemic youth unemployment. And you saw the trend lines. The transnational analytic insists on a panoramic picture depicting structures, processes, institutions that shape youth unemployment beyond the nation state and methodological nationalism. And I hope we'll talk about the methodology because I think this is really quite important contribution of this book. Ross and Nicola paint a group portrait of youth unemployment sweeping across 100 years, presenting data along two consequential historical periods. The development of youth unemployment spans 1919 to 1979, the age of extremes, as the late great Eric Hobsbawm entitled his last book in his quartet on capitalism. And as you heard, it foregrounds the conjuncture of neoliberal restructuring in 1991 to 2021. So the data is very up to the present, punctuated by the financial crisis and its aftermath. Masterfully, they array data by world region, corresponding to the topography of capitalism's uneven and unequal social division of labor in the world system. And their world regional approach goes beyond simple snapshots. Through a global and historical optic, we see sustained youth unemployment over time and variation by gender and between clusters of low, medium, and high income countries, which is quite an achievement. Their lush canvas with its expansive historical reference and global data set lays bare the inner workings of a capitalist growth machine. They make the compelling case that the global labor force is structurally differentiated by age and that youth occupy a universally disadvantaged position. Bidirectional fluidity of potential young workers captures the ebb and flow not only between employment, unemployment, and inactivity, but also crucially as vulnerably employed. And this is a category, and they operationalize this of it's very consequential and significant, and I hope that it becomes a standard part of our standard lexicon. And I'd like to talk more about this concept. It is really important not only to study youth employment and unemployment, but also global labor and the capitalist system more generally. Finally, the book brings in the state, the re-gearing of educational systems and social reproduction to explain how the global reserve army of youth labor operates. So from this very exciting book, it was very hard for me to pick out just a few things to focus on, because as you see, it's a very capacious. I'm going to raise 3 points for our discussion. My first point is about macro theory of gendered systems in relationship to capitalism and the restructuring of social reproduction. So the book and the presentation talked about how capitalism thrives on the hidden abode of social reproduction for one, underwriting the total cost of reproduction of labor power, two, serving as a reservoir for absorbing unused labor power, and three, producing and sustaining the labor force. Nicola's research on care, Jane Pillinger's research also on vulnerability and sexual assault are very important in terms of theorizing the patriarchal systems or gender regimes in relationship to capitalism. So it's the structuring logic of gendered hierarchies and how it shapes the dynamic of labor exploitation. So I'd like to say a few more words about this and have us discuss social reproduction more specifically. And they do in the book, and they did today, talk about how gender and age, the intersection of gender and age, positions young men and women differently in the International Social Division of Labor, but not only in the circuits of capital, but also in the sphere of social reproduction. So it's social reproduction, it's not just a adjunct to production, but it's a sphere in and of itself with a logic. In the work that Nicola has done and the research on global care chains, that we see that girls, the reserve army of labor works quite differently in terms of how they're absorbed in the household and the work they do in the household. So the dynamic intra-household and inter-household on a global scale. So more about that. My second issue is about age and the further segmentation of labor markets. What we see is a category of labor, a flexible category of labor of internships. Internships have been around for a long time, but now they're being used as a flexible tool, as a revolving door of disposable youth workers, not only in the global north, but also in the global south. So you see in China, for example, Foxconn hires interns from vocational schools during peak periods, or lower wages, even lower than the short-term contracts of young migrant workers that they work alongside. So the educational system is quite important. And so the institutional connections and coupling and decoupling. My final question or comment is one about the dynamic of the global reserve army of youth labor. How it not only disciplines labor, but also produces disorder. And the comment and question is the instability that we see in particular conjunctures like today, is it a spark of recent global waves of social movements? We saw it was a spark to the Arab Spring on the one hand, Starbucks baristas on the other, the movement of democracy movement, umbrella movement in Hong Kong, and today in Iran. So are these contra-hegemonic movements, and how are they critical for transforming policy landscapes? So let me end where the book ends by directing your attention to their manifesto for a global compact on youth employment. They set out goals and standards and objectives that I think are important for a global compact. It's a call to action built on a compelling analytical edifice. And I look forward to our discussion today.
Fantastic, Heidi. Brilliant analysis, spot on for timing as well. So lots of really important challenges that you've raised there around, you know, the gender, social reproduction of labor, about gendered hierarchies, around age segmentation, around the reserve army of labor, and this amazing manifesto for action. So thank you, Heidi, so much. And I think this is going to provoke a really interesting discussion in the moment. But before we do that, I want to secondly turn to Robin Simmons, who is Professor of Education at the University of Huddersfield. And Robin, I want to hand over to you now, and it's really great to have you here with your educational perspective. So thanks, Robin.
Thank you, Jane. What I want to do this evening is focus mainly on chapter 2 of the book, but also draw on other chapters, chapter 7 and 8, and the book more generally. Within that, there are three themes that I want to talk about, really. The first theme is youth unemployment as a question of social policy. The second thing I want to talk about is the global dimension of youth unemployment. And the third theme I want to talk about, questions of governance of endemic youth unemployment. So first of all, to begin, youth unemployment as an issue of social policy. I think this is a very important message from the book. And central to Nicola and Ross's argument is that youth unemployment is not merely an economic or an individual problem rooted in psychology, motivation, other dispositions, but it's a social problem. And because it's a social problem, it's a matter for social policy. And I think that is really an important lesson from the book. And I think it's a point that is often overlooked or missed or ignored. And I think practitioners and indeed policymakers concerned with youth unemployment often conceive it first and foremost as an individual question or an individual problem. And youth unemployment tends often to be associated with a bundle of pathologies, including problematic attitudes, values, aspirations, mental health, and so on. So there are questions of cause and effect. And I have heard practitioners in particular say, well, it's a chicken and egg situation. Well, I'm not quite sure it is. It is a two-way street, but I think what Nicola and Ross reinforce and make me think is actually largely those social and economic forces shape the way that young people respond. Undoubtedly, youth unemployment has significant deleterious effects upon young people, and the notion of the scarring effect of youth unemployment, I think, is really well explained in this book, in particular in chapter two. So the notion of scarring, the idea that youth unemployment has an ongoing and sustained effect throughout life, and not just in the labour market. So yes, it does have an effect in terms of vulnerability to adult unemployment, lower earnings and so on, insecure work as an adult. But the other things that are drawn out in relation to health, housing, relationships, well-being. And I think this book does that in a really incisive way. And I think one of the ways that Nicola and Ross help us to understand this is drawing at various points on the work of the great American sociologist C. Wright Mills and the notion of the sociological imagination. This idea that, you know, youth unemployment is often seen as a personal trouble, but is actually a public issue and should therefore be the concern and focus of social policy. And that reminds me, you know, Mills is in many ways a forgotten or overlooked thinker. And this idea of a sociological imagination, in some ways it's quite a simple idea, but it's also a very powerful idea. And I think it's worth stepping back and thinking not just about youth unemployment, but various social phenomena using this framework. And reading chapter two in particular made me think that. It really brought Mill's work back to me. So thank you for that. So this idea that youth unemployment is a social policy issue. So the study of youth unemployment should focus on welfare systems, the role of the state. And something else that really came out is that, you know, there are political choices that can be made. The global dimension is extremely important and it's explained really well. But nation states do still matter. And there are choices that can be made that will either ameliorate or exacerbate youth unemployment. And I think that comes through quite vividly, really. And the final point on this section is the other thing that comes through to me is that, yes, young people are vulnerable And I noticed that, you know, this question about the precariat, but it's also important to remember that all young people are vulnerable, but the effects are differentiated in terms of race, ethnicity, gender, and indeed social class. So that insecurity is felt much more keenly by those from more deprived material backgrounds than their more affluent peers, I guess. So that's the first theme, and it really got me thinking, and I felt very stimulated reading chapter two, and then going into the other sections of the book. So the second theme then, I wanted to think about this idea of youth and employment being global in nature, and that comes through very strongly throughout the book in different ways. And Ross and Nicola look not only in the UK, the EU, but obviously the Middle East, Sub-Saharan Africa, the Americas, and so on. And they quite skillfully draw out some of the similarities and differences in youth and employment in different contexts around the globe. And I think, linking back to the point I made earlier, what it reminds me is yes, these things are global, but there are differences that are in part to do with choice. And thinking about the different parts of the EU, those nations which are more or less social democratic or neoliberal, and the way that they treat and deal with unemployed youth is quite significant. And it's important to remember that there are more or less punitive or humane ways of going about approaching youth unemployment. The final point about this stuff about the global nature of unemployment, the stuff obviously on some of the low-income countries, and the existence of lots of subsistence work means that in many ways the data on youth unemployment is difficult to understand. But one thing that came to my mind, and I think throughout, is this idea that inclusion and exclusion can sometimes be a false dichotomy, in as much as you can still be excluded whilst officially taking part in education and work. So this idea of advanced marginalisation that Wakant uses, I think, is quite powerful. Okay, almost going to finish now, folks. I'm aware that I'm running out of time. Questions of global governance. A number of things I was going to say about that, but I'm going to concentrate on one particular theme, and that's in especially the role of education in youth unemployment, and the notion of warehousing in particular, which comes through quite strongly. The precariat's been mentioned, but it's difficult not to come back to kind of classic Marxist concept of the reserve army of labour here, and education being complicit in that. Although the final thing I would say about the reserve army of labour is, in a way, the term army is wrong, because army implies a degree of organisation and kind of collectivity that I think is missing largely from unemployed youth, because neoliberalism in general has purposely disorganized, fragmented, individualized, well, not only youth, but the labor force in general. So this warehousing, this reserve army of labor, yeah, I'd get that, but I'm struggling for a term that captures it better, actually, because there's this disorganization and there's this malaise as well that we need to understand. So thank you, Jane. I think that's probably about 8 minutes or so, maybe a touch longer. You're muted, Jane.
Thank you. Would help if I unmuted myself. So fascinating. Thank you so much, Robin. And only 1 minute over time, so it's perfect. And I think some really important issues around the social policy lens, the issues around global governance, setting this in a global context is really important. And I was thinking as you were speaking, Robin, about, you know, the complex transitions that young people have into adulthood these days and the complexity of young people's lives. And if this is intersected with social class, race, gender and age, you can see the vulnerabilities of certain groups of young people. So I think it was really helpful to raise those issues, and particularly in the context of a massive rising rates of mental ill health amongst young people today. So these are really great challenges that both Heidi and Robin have raised in their responses to the book. And I'm going to pass back now to Ross and Nicola. You might have some particular responses you'd like to make to some of the points raised, or you might want to just enlarge on some of the issues that Heidi and Robin have flagged up here. So over to you for a few minutes.
Nicola, go on, your mouth open, you're about to say something.
I think I was just breathing, actually.
Oh, well, you are all right. In which case, keep breathing. Don't stop. I was only going to suggest, because there is so much, it's so rich. That's a day. What Heidi and Robin between them have presented would be a fantastic day's seminar. It would be magnificent. And I just trying to think of some way of getting through at least some of it. I was going to suggest, Nicola, but no problem at all if you don't like this. I know Robin's work a bit better than I know Heidi's. You know Heidi's a bit better than I know than Robin's, probably. And so I was going to offer to go backwards a bit through Robin's, but I won't get right at the beginning of his, and you could start at the front end of, or anywhere else you wanted to in Heidi's. Craig, I can't remember if you're, or well, actually, I shouldn't be calling on Craig. I should be calling on Jane. I'm not. Roughly, how long have we got for this session? I haven't got my little timetable thing
around,
in front of me.
Around 5 minutes to give your responses.
Each.
Between you.
Between. Oh, right. Okay. Right. Speak fast.
You've got 5 minutes.
Okay. Terrific. Look, I mean, I think I will work backwards through yours, Robin, if I may. I think your point about global armies and organisation is, I mean, in one way, it's become kind of quite lazy. I mean, it was very significant in early Marxist thinking and some of what Engels was talking about. So much is so different, and in a sense. Armies are like a kind of a military organization into which people are dragooned, and you could say that kind of happens to a lot of young people, dragged into work reluctantly and then chucked out of it rudely with no expectation. And to that extent, there's an army analogy, but it so doesn't catch it in so many other ways, except in the sense that in the end, you can never escape that concept of disposable labor, disposable, yes. Usable, yes. And yes. one of the big and interesting issues to me is how it is that employers and the education system kind of try to accommodate one another. And it's quite interesting to see what's going on now about Rishi Sunak's much more interested in the technical, not interested in tertiary education at all. Mm-hmm. And those are ways that you could say is breaking down that kind of it makes work more accessible for young people who haven't necessarily got academic backgrounds. There's a whole lot more work to be done on that, but I think you're really right to draw attention to it. And the whole issue of the global governance and of warehousing, I think is time to be, you can open it up in any number of states, including the UK. Okay, I've probably had half of my 2 minutes or as it is, and I'm just going to look back through one other I'm absolutely spoiled for choice here. So I'm going to go back to your point at the beginning about social policy. And in one way, it's rather lazy of me to do this because I agree with all of it. And I think what I think you were pointing towards, and I'm certainly picking up on, is if you try to do labour market and labour market entry without it having a place of the social and the integrative and the transitional for young people who come from a very particular kind of regime, a school into a very different kind of regime, a place of work, then there's a whole lot of work to be done around that. But there's also a whole lot of stuff about rights in which young people, however unskilled, deserve to have the opportunity to work towards being able to account for themselves, contribute for themselves without being unrealistic about what they can do. So I think they're both really hot issues, and they're as hot now as they were, you know, 20, 50, 100 years ago. Thanks for your thoughts, Robin.
Thank you, Ross. Yeah.
Okay. I think that's left me with 1 minute.
Oh, God, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to thank actually both Robin and Heidi for A, reading the book, obviously, and to thank them for their generous and expansive comments. Is really making me think now, which is always great to revisit the book, you know, in the light of other people's perspectives and insights. I mean, all I can do really, I think, at the moment is to, and this actually connects with Heidi's question, partly, probably not very satisfactorily, which is about gender, age and gender, and the intersections of age and gender. And actually, this connects also with the point that Rod made about these intersections going on as well. So, I mean, in the book, we chronicle quite substantially, you know, the ways in which it's not just about age, but the ways in which young people are differentiated within that group. So quite often you see differences in the way that young people are treated, their entitlements, if they have any, between the younger kind of age, the younger end of the age spectrum and the older one. So it's certainly not a monolithic group. And again, within that, we have very pronounced gender dynamics going on. So at the beginning, when I introduced the book, I mentioned very briefly how unemployment rates are much higher, significantly higher for young women compared with young men on the whole. And that kind of, there's a whole hinterland of work which just demonstrates time and time again about the mutual construction or the mutual importance of age and gender in creating that notion of flexible labour, of disposable labour, and the casting in particular of young women. And young women occupy a very interesting role within the global economy, I must say. I mean, all the studies of outsourcing, particularly, you know, in the newly industrialised countries, as they were then, of East Asia, across South America, Central America, have all demonstrated that young women are differently positioned compared with young men. Young women, particularly educated young women, depends on sector, of course. This isn't a totalizing theory of youth labor. It depends on the sector, depends on the country, depends on particular conditions. But on the whole, young women are particularly, I wouldn't say privileged, but they're sought after. So what we see is employers, for example, in the what was then called the informatics industry, IT, as we might call it now, are being sought for. So their degree of education, if you take that as a proxy for social class, they're being sought, but they're educated, so they're literate, they're trained to be sufficiently self-guided and independent, be able to turn up for work, carry out commands diligently, single young women are particularly important. They're particularly sought out as well. They're much more favoured than married women, not least because they obviously kind of don't have the care responsibilities, or so it's assumed, even though we know they actually do. Quite often they're the key wage earners within a household. So educated women, single women, and child-free women also, again, signalling, you know, no need for maternity benefits, no need for maternity leave. Healthy works quite well as well, no need for sickness leave. So there's a whole kind of range of different aspects which is rooted in, I guess, the social protection regime thought of very broadly, that favours or discriminates between different groups of young people that we talk about. So I think that's all I want to say on that, and I'm aware that isn't a very satisfactory answer to Heidi's question, but maybe we can come back to that later.
Fantastic. Thanks, Nicola and Ross. And we've got a few moments now for Heidi and Robin to come back on those points. So I'm going to say about 3 to 4 minutes each, if that's okay. And it could be any other points that you want to raise that have come up in the responses from Ross and Nicola. So Heidi, should we pass over to you first? Thank you. Are you okay, Heidi?
Heidi's muted, I can see.
Can you hear me, Heidi? Can you unmute yourself? I'll tell you what we'll do. Why don't we pass over to Robin first, then, Robin, if you're okay, just to make a few comments in response.
And, yes, sir. Yes,
and
of
in
course.
The meantime, perhaps Heidi can be sorting out the
sure.
technology challenge. Thanks,
sure.
Robin.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Yes, I want to return to the question of the Reserve Army of Labour that Ross was speaking about a few minutes ago. There's the question of terminology. What is it? Is it an army? Is it something else? What is this disorganized cohort? But I think what is undoubtable is that we have this tranche of expendable labor that capital is able to use and dismiss at will almost. And there are a couple of things really that strike me, both from Ross's response and the content of the book. And it made me think about young people in different positions within this reserve pool, shall we call it. On one hand, as Nicola and Ross point out several times, particularly in many rich countries, there's a huge tranche of young people that are in fact underemployed and overqualified. And this goes against, well, official discourse that bangs on about skills and knowledge economy, the need for more education and training, all that kind of stuff that we hear ad nauseum. But when you look at the profile of young people in the West in particular, you know, they've never been more highly qualified or more educated. So there's that on one hand. On the other hand, if you look at the bottom end of the labour market, I'm reminded that you know, some forms of provision that supposedly equips young people to take part in work. And there have been various studies on this. I remember one in the UK, the Wolf Report, which goes back a long time ago. But what that showed is that actually by taking part in some forms of low-level vocational training, there was a negative labour market return for participants. And that is really quite staggering, isn't it? That by going on a course, you actually end up in a worse position than not going on the course. So this kind of stigmatising effect. So I suppose what we offer young people, how we treat young people, how we try and manage that transition is really, really important. And I think a bit of a segue here, but quite a big segue. I think it does link to this notion of the global compact for youth unemployment that you describe within the book. And my feelings on that are a mixed, really, because on the one hand, yeah, I get it. Yeah, I see your argument, and you know that could and should be a really good idea. And you mentioned how it might work. What worries me, what concerns me are two things. One, the practicalities and logistics of doing that on a global level. You mentioned various organisations that could be involved and how it might work, but I wonder how that might be managed. But the other thing, the bigger thing, is the kind of will and commitment, in as much as, you know, the dominant ideology is undoubtedly neoliberalism. It has spread and has a pernicious effect across the globe. And whilst that still dominates, I do wonder if there's the potential, the capacity to bring in this global compact for youth unemployment in a meaningful, sustained way. So they're my thoughts in response to those that Ross raised.
Thank you very much, Robin. I think Heidi, you're okay now. I can see you're unmuted. So are there a few points you'd like to raise? Can you hear me okay, Heidi?
Can't hear.
You can't hear. Okay. I don't know what the problem is, Heidi, but maybe we'll come back to you in a moment.
Yeah.
Sorry about this. It's really frustrating when the technology lets us down, but we're all used to it. We'll find a way around. So let's move on now. And just, I want to give the floor back to Nicola and Ross, because I think this point about the global compact is a really interesting one. And this is an opportunity for you to maybe just say a few words about the global compact proposal. And some of the problems associated with it. And so here, what's to be done? Okay.
Okay, right, thank you. I'm just going to, there we go. Okay, so the question, what to be done, what is to be done? That age old question, obviously, I think we can probably all agree, becomes ever more urgent. As days go by. So I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes talking about this and just outline for people the basic elements of what we're proposing and a few caveats that we can expand on in discussion. And I guess a starting point for this, and I think this was a comment made by one of our participants, Rusa, given that the UN system itself extracts unpaid labour for young people through its unpaid internship, which is a very good observation. But and I guess, you know, what's enshrined in the UN's sustainable development goals is ever more necessary, but all too readily falls foul, not only of neoliberalism and the dominance of neoliberalism that has taken hold of global institutions, especially over the past 30, 40 years, but also of the weaknesses and the fragmentation of the global governance the global governance of the global economy, and the institutional schism that we see that was set up in those global institutions right from the start between what's between the institutions of global economic governance and the institutions of global social governance. Okay, so that's a fundamental division which was established right from the off. So in response, and this is partly a critique of the UN's 2030 strategy for young people, you know, given we'd written the book, we were thinking, okay, what next? What does this mean for the real world, so-called? So in the final chapter, we sketch out some ideas for a global compact for youth employment. There we go, slightly slow, but there you go, got there eventually. So let's talk about this and its different components in a few minutes. So a first and foremost priority for a global compact is to give concrete meaning to the SDG goal 8.5. It's here on the chart here, on the slide. So that's the first fundamental point. So I'm just going to talk through a few points about what it could entail. So specifically then, so we're proposing a full employment target for young people to be measured in terms of youth unemployment and not youth employment, as is currently the case. And in this, I guess our thinking was very much guided by a really powerful report at the end of the 1940s, just at the outset of the UN institutions or the UN system in 1949, in a report on full employment. So we've kind of looked at that and we thought about it and revised it and kind of this is our own take on it. So a principal objective of that would be to facilitate a substantial levelling up, and I'm aware that word has particular connotations in the UK, of viable employment for young people. We're talking about needing to inject clear targets and standards of attainment, which obviously accompanied by unwavering obligations and accountability, which includes powers to award as well as retract funds. Such targets and standards would take on real meaning, we suggest, when seen as part of a wider youth employment macroeconomic stabilisation policies. And the Global Compact would necessarily be universal, so it would be apply to all members of the UN and subject, therefore, to its normative framework on human rights. Few more specifics on governance, on the governance dimensions of this. So for this, we're talking about some profound principles of, first of all, shared responsibility among the global north and the global south, the global east and the global west. We're talking about inclusiveness, that priority countries would through the governance structures, have a sense of ownership of this compact. This isn't something done to them by the rich countries of the global north, but it would also include, of course, civil society actors, workers' representatives in the governance, in the core governance of the compact at global level, and not just in program delivery at the local level. And that is an issue with lots of these current programs generally, that, you know, inclusiveness about to multi-stakeholder engagement when drawing up local projects. But when you actually look at the ways in which global initiatives, like, for example, the Global Fund or other such things, it's actually very restricted in terms of who's actually on the governing board. And that matters. That really, really matters. Third is transparency and accountability. There obviously need to be effective and very strong, robust instruments. We're talking about an empowered UN Economic and Social Council. So at the moment, the UN, this council, ECOSOC, doesn't have very many powers. We would want to see that greatly empowered, including, but it would oversee the rollout of a global youth employment programme, which includes targets and standards to be attained and scheduled stabilisation monitoring and reporting procedures. Okay, so this isn't something that's kind of tucked away, as it were, in the offices of the ILO. This is core to the UN. This is something that all nations sign up to. Now, UNESCO and the ILO have been absolutely key in pushing for the development, the specification of standards, and of how norms on human rights apply to young people over the course of last 70 years or so. However, they suffer or experience maybe some fundamental problems which are actually institutional. So what we're proposing are that both of those, both of whom are critical, that they're also empowered with financial and legal powers to strengthen policy frameworks to support the objectives of the compact. And that's one of the key differences that we're proposing as part of this compact. And of course, it would need to be funded. We always have to think about who pays, and that could, some obvious candidates would be the IMF, very powerful, the World Bank, and high income countries. So, of course, they would be key amongst those bearing the primary share of funding, and there would be a need to look at additional sources of funding. And we can talk more about that if there's time. So that's our proposed global compact. It's purposefully ambitious, it's potentially costly, and some might say wholly and utterly unrealistic. It touches on very sensitive geoeconomic and geopolitical issues, but far more costly, we would argue, as well as deeply, deeply unjust, are the multitudes of invisible lifetime scars that hundreds of millions of young people suffer in all kinds of ways that shape their life and their life chances, including their chances of dying very young. So it's admittedly sketchy. Okay, we know that requires further consideration. And of course, you're absolutely right, Robin. Neoliberalism is an absolutely fundamental problem in this. So we don't have a strategy for upending that. And I should say that this is a compact which is very much within capitalism. Okay, we haven't gone to what this might look like outside of capitalism, so that's important for context. It is something that's possible. It was considered at the beginning of the 20th century, when the first international institutions of the kind that we know were set up, and again at the end of the Second World War with the establishment of the UN. But the proposals in practice, what happened in practice was that it got massively watered down by the government of the time. However, if it's been considered once, then surely it can be considered again. At least that's the view that we take. And it may well provide a broad roadmap for a socially just world that releases young people from anger, violence, despair, and welcomes them as full and equal members in the multitude worlds of work and beyond. So this is our so-called manifesto. There are obviously limitations. We're very happy to discuss it. We put it on the table as something that's maybe a little bit outside of the realm of what's being discussed as possible at the moment within those policy forums. There are examples in other dimensions, in health, for example. There's a number of global funds, like them or love them or hate them or loathe them. There are these models that do exist, you know, governments and workers' representatives and employers and others actually have devised these instruments as it were, and I don't want to put this down to being a technical kind of arrangement, but they do actually exist. There are predecessors in a broad sense. So if anything, as academics, I think what we can do is to think the impossible, ponder the improbable, and after all, isn't it our prerogative to imagine an alternative and a much better and brighter future? So undoubtedly, there will be massive, there would be, you know, going forward, there's a whole range of different considerations to be taken forward and given flesh to that. But that is, I think, our modest contribution, our modest proposal.
Thanks, Nicola. Well, even getting a modest proposal through it, the climate we're in at the moment is ambitious, but I think it's fantastic to see the framework that you've set out there. We haven't got much time left now, and there's a few questions, so I just wanted to quickly run through the questions, and then rather than take each question in turn, I'll just flag up the questions and then leave it for our panel to respond to which or whatever questions they think are relevant to their area of expertise. So Rod has a question about, you know, high income countries and how differentiated was the unemployment of young people in terms of gender or ethnicity. I think that's been covered to some extent, but you might want to add something about that. Rosa argues, you know, asked the question about global level responses that you'd recommend. I think you've set that out very well. And as she mentions, the UN system extracts from this labour force through its unpaid internship system. In fact, you can't get a job in the UN unless you do several internships, which is only available to middle class, you know, well, good income families who are able to support those interns. So it's a even further division there. Chris Grover takes up the issue about the Reserve Army of Labour and, you know, essentially about embedding youth unemployment in individualising discourses. Rod also, he says, I think the research suggests that the main determinant of ethnic unemployment differential is the longer duration of unemployment experienced by ethnic minorities. Does this start in early adulthood in high income countries, and how does your data set grapple with race effects? And I think that's, yes, and Rod raises the issue about racial capitalism as well and colonial legacies. So we literally have 10 minutes left. If there's anybody else that wants to ask any questions, please put them up. And it might be that they don't get responded to at the moment, but certainly our panel may be able to respond to you separately. So I'm just going to see if Heidi has managed to get back in. Are you there, Heidi? Can you hear us? Can you connect? Just to give you the first parting shot.
Hi, Jane. Craig here. Just really sorry, I'm in contact with her, but she seems to have dropped out and is having problems connecting back in. So will be on standby to let her in.
Thanks, Craig. We'll look out for her. So Robin, over to you. Have you any responses to any of the questions, or indeed anything that Nicola raised in terms of the Global Compact?
Yeah, in terms of the Global Compact, I think there's some very very good points raised by Nicola, in as much as this or something similar, you know, has been on the agenda in the past. But something needs to happen, doesn't it? Something needs to happen to make a change in direction. But it is possible, in as much as nothing lasts forever, does it? And when we think about neoliberalism, you know, until the 1970s, essentially it was regarded as a kind of a fairly marginal minority endeavor, wasn't it? But it became mainstream. It became mainstream quickly, and in a very kind of brutal way, seized power and spread. But I think it needs neoliberalism to be disempowered, to be pushed back, to be slapped down, because then I think the things that you describe become more possible. And I think you know, you make a very powerful point, in as much as, you know, it is important to put these things on the agenda and to think in challenging ways. And I think you mentioned thinking about the impossible. It's not the impossible, but I do think something does need to change to, you know, to enable it to happen, I guess.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, and that, and there are contemporary examples of people putting modest proposals on the table. You know, you need the right constellation of political forces and advocates who will back those ideas. You know, and it's a long road. Yeah. It is a long road, as we know. But, you know, we're here for the long term. So, you know, I guess you have to see this as an historical movement, really,
sure,
rather than something that can happen within 5 years, even. But yeah, absolutely. Can I just respond to a point that Rod has been raising about race and ethnicity? And I just wanted to say, actually, Rod, that we don't look at race and ethnicity as in terms of social divisions within the book. The data available on that is absolutely dire. It was really, really dire within international data set, which is the sources that we were looking at. There's absolutely nothing on it. They have all kinds of other ways in which you can kind of cross-cut data, but race doesn't feature amongst that. So we don't discuss it, and that is a limitation of the book. Now, racial capitalism, I think, is absolutely a helpful characterization of the global economy. I absolutely agree 100%. We don't do that. We haven't incorporated that into this book. So sorry to disappoint you on that. We didn't have the data that we would have liked in order to make those kinds of, you know, to intervene or to contribute to those debates.
Ross, would you like to respond to any of the questions? And actually, just while you say that, Nicola, actually, it's really important around the recommendations to have far better data systems, because I think, you know, when we look at the intersection around race, gender and age, I mean, really, that data doesn't exist at all on any indicators, actually.
Yeah. And the number of times that that we have made that point on, you know, about the need for better data. And it's incredibly boring for people to listen to, but it's absolutely fundamental to have a recommendation on strengthening data infrastructures.
All right, Ross,
I was just going to agree with at least one of the core messages of Chris Grover's a message. Hi, Chris, if you're still there to hear this. I take your point very strongly about heterodox political economy as a counter to orthodox analyses that essentially embed youth unemployment in individualizing discourses. So I agree there's a way in which the whole idea of reserve armies needs to be thought about very carefully. I'm not sure I can wind my way through that, because I don't want to go back to reserve armies yet again. But I think it's an area that deserves further thought, and I'll try and send you an email about it, which may not be very satisfactory, but at least it's a recognition that you're raising an important issue, I think.
Thanks, Ross. So we've just got like 2 minutes left, so I'm just going to ask each of you just to make a final, just closing statement. And somebody says, "Is the book in the library?" We hope so.
It's in the Open University Library, I think.
Yeah. Open University Library.
Or at least in electronic form.
Yeah. So, Robin, just a very brief final closing.
Thank you. Thank you, Jane. Yes, thank you for inviting me today. I've enjoyed the book hugely. It's a very powerful book. It's an important book. It's an important book on a number of levels that everybody has talked about today. The thing that I've not said, really, I think is also important, is actually it's a very forensic book as well, and the way that data is used is actually hugely impressive. And I get that there are gaps in data, but the way that data is mobilized to illustrate points is really, really good. So thanks once again.
Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Ah,
yes,
Heidi. Oh, lovely to have you back. Briefly, a final comment. I'm sorry. Okay. That
sorry
we lost you.
I'm sorry. Yes, I'm sorry that I finally used my iPhone, so I learned something from my my young child. So I just wanted to echo what Robin said. The book is really so rich in data. They amass global data sets. I think it's one of the, I think it is the only book that looks not only at economic data, but also governance institutions, and goes through each of those historically. The book can be read, a deep dive into each of the chapters, and then across all of the chapters to get a very important story. And I think it's a story of age that compels us to rethink our categories, to rethink our understandings, whether we use the reserve army of labor or not, whether we find a new term. What the book does is it shows why we need a concept that links different parts of the world, that has a relational perspective. And their data set allows for looking at differences and similarities across different global regions so that we can begin to map on south-south, north-south relationships. So I recommend the book. And my last statement is to show you again a very important book. It's my constant companion. So thank you again for inviting me.
How wonderful. How wonderful to have a book like this as your constant companion. So many, many thanks to Heidi, to Robin, and many congratulations to Nicola and Ross for this fantastic book. I really recommend people to read it, to order it for your libraries, to review it, to circulate it, to get youth employment issues back on the policy agendas at national levels, at global levels, and bring it back into our discussions about social policy. Because actually what I realized when I first looked at the book is that youth employment and unemployment has really slipped off all policy agendas. And it's great that you spotted this gap in national policy and global policy. And many, many congratulations to you both. So I think, you know, just a final word to say, buy the book and buy it in the next 2 weeks and you get a big discount. And Nicola, did you have a slide that just gives some information about how you can buy the book and what discount you get? And I think there's a code you have to put in.
There is.
You
need to have the code. Let me just, here we go, as if by magic.
There it is.
You'll wish it that. Oh, no.
There it is. Fantastic.
There we go.
So chapter one is 50%
off. What a bargain.
50%. Fantastic. Fantastic. So again, many, many thanks, Heidi. We're sorry we missed you for a little bit, but many thanks for coming in at the end here. Many thanks to Robin and delighted to Ross and Nicola. And particularly a big call out to Craig Walker, who has been really fantastic, giving us enormous technical support, helping to set all of this up. So thank you so much, Craig. You've been absolutely brilliant in getting this up and running. We couldn't have done it without you. And thank you also to you as participants. And I hope you have a good evening, a good midday, a good afternoon, whichever part of the world you're in. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.